became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. So amazing, love so amazing, Jesus Messiah.
God, we love you. We thank you for your grace and your mercy and how we have redemption through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that made it possible for us to be in relationship with our Heavenly Father. God, I pray that you be with Brother Ron as he speaks this morning. Lord, I pray you hide him behind the cross. In what he shares, may our ears be open, our hearts be open, our minds be open to your truth from your word. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
And I am looking forward, so forward to coming back next week and meeting with our church family in our worship services at 8:30 and 10:30. We're excited about that. And again, going through the process a little slow, just bringing it back in slowly and just trying to take care of all the things around here. But we're looking forward to, the blessing of being back together next week. Take your Bibles, if you could, please, today and turn to Psalm chapter 3. Psalm chapter 3. And I pray that you're at home there with your families or maybe by yourself and worshiping with us and being a part of this service with us today. Psalm chapter 3. I want to talk to you this morning on this subject, what to do when you're living in chaos. What to do in chaos times, in chaotic times. What do we do? How can we live in this world in the midst of chaos? I find myself, my wife and I talk about it. Sometimes we watch TV and we see what's going on. And one of the things that we say, we hear ourselves saying over and over again, we say things like this. We say, well, that's crazy. That's crazy. And then something the next channel turns on, that's crazy. And before long, we just find ourselves this crazy, crazy, chaotic times. Often we see the craziness around us, and we talk about a lot. You could talk about coronavirus. You could talk about the political system. Politics has dominated the news waves now for quite a while. Debates and the craziness of all that we see today. In fact, again, you look around us and it just seems like you can't stop and be calm at all because everything else around us is just going haywire. And that's truly the way things are today. And I think in the midst of it, I find myself, and we've done this before and I've heard this, I'm listening to other people say this as well as myself, but we'll say things like this, man, it's just terrible. Things are going on. It's crazy out there. Man, this virus is just taking people. It's down. It's just, what do we do? Can we go out? Can we not go out? Can we go here? Can we go there? And before long, you say, I'm going to stay home. And you stay home and you watch TV. And you watch all the political craziness that's going on today. And you look around and you just go, what is the world coming to? I mean, it's just, you see evil. You see lying. You see backbiting. You see all kinds of different things today. And you just go, this is crazy. And if you're not careful, you can get into sort of a tailspin of depression. And you can start looking around at a gloom and doom prospect to say, you know what, it's doomsday, things are terrible, it's over, things are going to be bad and never be the same. And then what we do is we do something like this. All right, I've done this. We'll say, oh, it's terrible, things are going on, it's just craziness out there. And then we'll tack on a little phrase and we'll say this, but God is in control. We tack that on like it's a little afterthought. Oh, it's terrible. You see the politics, what's going on, but God is in control. You see this virus, it's crazy, people are dying, but God is in control. And I think what we need to start doing as believers in Jesus Christ is to stop for a moment instead of just tacking that on at the end of a gloom and doom kind of conversation. We need to stop for a moment and just say, you know what, first and foremost, our God is in control. Our God is the sovereign God of the universe, and He controls it all, as Patrick said a moment ago. That needs to be the initial part of our conversation. Because if we start with that part of the conversation, it sort of puts everything else into perspective. We should treat the Lord Jesus Christ as He is Lord, as He is. Again, as I think about it, Psalm chapter 3 is a great illustration for us today. As we stop for a moment and say, how can we live our life in this day and time with the confidence, security, and again, just sufficient attitude that God is in control. Now, we know it and we believe it in our heart, but how can we live it out in everyday life with all the things around us? Well, David is again a great illustration of this in Psalm chapter 3. So if you have your Bible, look at Psalm chapter 3 and look at what it says. It says, a psalm of David, look, listen, when he fled from Absalom, his son. Lord, how they have increased who trouble me. Many are they who rise up against me. Many are they who say of me, there is no help for him in God. And then the great word we're going to look at here in a moment, Selah. But you, O Lord, are a shield for me, my glory and the one who lifts up my head. I cried, verse 4, I cried to the Lord with my voice, and he heard me from his holy hill. There's the word, Selah. I lay down and slept. I awoke, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid, verse 6, listen, I will not be afraid of 10,000s of people who have set themselves against me all around. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God, for you have struck all my enemies on the cheekbone. You have broken the teeth of the ungodly. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessing is upon your people. And then there's that word again, Selah. It's a great psalm. It's a very unique psalm. It's the first time the word psalm is used in the Bible. Again, the Hebrew word psalm is the word mitzmor. It's a word that means a song or a poem that is to be sung with an accompaniment. It's really, again, the literal translation is to pluck the strings. So what we're seeing is a song. David writes a song. He's going through a difficult, difficult time in his life, and God gives him a song. Again, as we think about our life, we think about David's life, what was going on. We think about all the chaos, the turmoil, the uncertainty in our day. But the background of this text is this. David is going through a very difficult time. In fact, David's life at this point is just seems to be going from bad to worse. Have you ever had one of those moments in life? When just, you know, bad is good because bad is better than worse that's coming up. I hear people say it all the time. Say, I just got to get through this year. 2020 has been one of those years. I don't wish my life away, but you know what? It just seems this is bad, and it just keeps getting worse and worse and worse and worse. That was David's life here. It reminds me of the doctor who called one of his patients, got him on the phone and said, John, I've got some bad news and I've got some worse news. And he said, well, okay, doc, give me the bad news. What's the bad news? He said, the bad news is you only have 24 hours to live. He said, you're kidding me. He said, what's the worst news? He said, I tried to call you yesterday and couldn't get a hold of you. That's where we are today. I mean, do turn around and say, you know what? It's bad news. But then tomorrow, it's just bad, and it's just bad, and it's just bad, and everything just... David was in that mode. David was in the mode of every time he turned around, something else would go wrong. And David, at this point, his life is getting worse and worse and worse. The issue is this. He had people coming against him, none other than his son, Absalom. Not only did Absalom rebel against him, but he'd taken the kingdom away from him, and now he was coming after his daddy. He was coming after David. David's life was literally falling apart. The nation had been deceived by Absalom. Absalom's a slick guy. In fact, if you read a story about Absalom, he would go down and he would intercept the people from his father, the judgment part of his. He'd go down and he would say, hey, I'll take care of this for you. I'll take care of this for you. And the Bible says he would kiss them. He just would talk to him very sweet and talk to him, very handsome young man. And for years, what he did was intercept people, pour into their life a little bit, love on them so that they would turn their backs eventually when at his say-so from his father. David now had gone from being a king to a criminal. He was on the run and he was ridiculed. He was talked as a coward. Many people thought he was a coward. He's running from his son. And one morning, the armies of Absalom come in closer and they say, you know what? It's going to be over. We're going to take him out. And what God did for him is what we need. David's life appeared to be over. It appeared to be done. And God, all of a sudden, right on time, gave David a word from God, and a great song that we see in chapter 3. They were closing in. God gave him a word. And I was thinking in my own life, isn't it great when God gives us a word? God gives us a foundational word of truth that we can stand on and go forward, even in the midst of all kinds of trials and tribulations that we deal with today. Now, I told you about the word Selah there. Look down in your Bible there. It's mentioned in this chapter, chapter 3, three times. I believe it's about 71 times in the whole book of Psalm. But in this verse, in this chapter, it's mentioned about three times. And each time we're going to see this word Selah is the word for break. It's going to break the down. So I'm going to give you how God breaks it down through this song. The word Selah means to pause or to reflect is the Hebrew word. It means there. What do you think about that? In other words, pause for a moment, reflect for a moment, and then just ask yourself the question, what do you think about that? That's what the word means, and that's what the word is saying here. It's put down here to reflect so that David can, and the other people that are singing, can stop for a moment and reflect on what's being said. What God has done in this passage is this. He slowed down David's life in the midst of chaos, in the midst of turmoil. He's made him pause for a moment and watch and reflect on who God is. And isn't that the real thing that we need sometimes? To stop in the middle of the chaos that we're facing in this world and just pause for a moment in our busyness, in our distress and distractions, and stop for a moment and just go, that's right, I am a child of God. Oh, you are God. Yeah, that's right, you are in charge. Yes, sir, you are in control. And what it does for David is what it'll do for us. It'll give us peace when we trust in the Lord. So what God does is this. He stops David, he pauses David in the midst of this, and there's three things I want to give you this morning as we look at this passage. Three modes that David's in, three areas that he's in. Number one, first thing we see in David's life in this verse 1 and following is David, first of all, I would say, is in panic mode. He's in panic mode. He's in stress mode. You're in stressful. It's chaotic times, and he's trying to find out, what can I do? My life is over. Everything's done. And he stops for a moment in his panic mode. He's fearful. He's running away from the enemy in fear. And verse 1 says this, a psalm of David, when he fled from Absalom, his son. Lord, how they have increased. That word increased in the Hebrew means pressure. It means multitudes on all sides. In other words, it is not just a little bit of increase. It's multiplied increase, which pressured point too. So it's a pressure-packed word. It's a multiplied word. So you understand, David is not just getting it from one side. He's getting it from all sides. Particularly, he's getting it from his son. And by the way, he's getting it from his son, whom he loves with all his heart. He loves his son. You say, well, he's mean, he's evil. He is, but he loves his son. And the heart of David is just being stomped on by his son. It's being pressured, the fact that he's coming after him. He's rebelled against him. He's trying to take over the kingdom. And the truth is, he wants to kill his father. As we see David, he's in panic mode. Have you ever been in panic mode? Have you ever been in that fearful mode of just running and running and running? I think we see that a lot in our life today. We get so busy that we don't stop and reflect on the Lord, and as a result, we're in panic mode all the time. It's like running your car high on RPMs. I mean, if you keep running and running and running and running, you're going to blow the engine. And that's what's happening to many people today. Believers in particular, as we don't stop for a moment and see who God is and what he's done in our life, and we can stop for a moment and say, oh, God, it's all about you. It's not about me. It's about what your plan is, not the circumstances that I see around me. David was in panic mode. First thing we see with David is this. He's stressed because of his circumstances. Stressed. Again, Absalom, his son, chasing him. Numbers increasing day by day. And again, Absalom, handsome, smooth-talking liar. I mean, I'm telling you, he came out and he just was the enemy portrayed. David's heart was broken. A British statesman, James Callahan, said this, "A lie can be halfway around the world before the truth has got its boots on." There's something in the heart of man that enjoys feeding on lies. We see that today, don't we? Listen, it doesn't matter what people say. They can say a lie, bold-faced lie on TV, and you can look at that and go, that's not true, but people believe it. You can be at work, you can be at school, and somebody tell a lie on somebody, and they say, yeah, that's not true. And it's like, it doesn't matter, people believe it. That was Absalom. And David, again, because of Absalom's rebellion, because of, again, the situation with the family there and with the situation with the army and the situation with the people, everywhere he turned, his life, because of the circumstances, was stressful. David's enemies were turning on him quickly, coming after him. And you understand, they weren't just stopping and saying, hey, let's just talk about it. They were trying to kill him. He was in a place he thought he would never be, in a situation he thought he would never get out of. Question, have you ever been in there? That situation where you thought, I'll never get out of this. Here's a situation. I never dreamed I would be in this situation. Well, those come up, don't they? The circumstances of life can sometimes squeeze us and pressure us into panic mode. Not only was David stressed out by his circumstances, he was also stressed out by the consequences of his sin. You remember the story, if we had time to go through it. Remember, part of the chastening process of David was this whole situation. He committed murder, he committed adultery, and as a result, God forgave him of that, but the consequences still remain. Someone told me a long time ago, said, you know, Ron, the truth is this, you cut your hand off, tomorrow you say, Lord, I ask you to forgive me for cutting my hand off. You'll have forgiveness from God, but you'll still have no hand tomorrow. Consequences come. The wages of sin is still death. The judgment of God comes. We talk about the love of God many, many times. But understand this, it's the judgment of God, the wrath of God also that we have to learn about as well. And this grace and mercy comforts us in the midst, even in the midst of difficult circumstances and the consequences of sin. Absalom was a part of those consequences, and David was broken over his sin and broken over how his family turned out because of his sin. Not only was David stressed out because of the consequences and circumstances, again, as we mentioned, he's also stressed out by the confrontation of the enemy. Verse 1, a psalm of David, when he fled from Absalom, his son, Lord, how they have increased who trouble me. And he says, many are they who rise up against me. Folks, we have enemies today, don't we? All around us. Everywhere we go. You know, the Bible tells us we have several enemies. We have the world, the flesh, and the devil. Someone has said this, the world is my external foe, the flesh is my internal foe, and the devil is my eternal foe. And the truth is, we can stop for a minute and look at our life, 24/7, constant enemies. Did you understand? We're in a battle as Christians. Did you know that, right? It's not just political. It's not just the economy. It's not just, listen, We have an enemy that is out to destroy us. He's walking around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. He knows he can't get to God, so he goes after the ones that God loves. That's me and that's you. So you understand, this is no picnic. I wonder sometimes in our Christian life, we get so relaxed and get so complacent that we're sort of like a gazelle in the field when a lion is just stalking. You see, the one that gets attacked, the one that gets eaten is the one that just sort of relaxed and he's just not paying attention. You see, several of them, they're alert, they're watching, they're listening, they're watching, they're listening, and they run. But the one is just sort of standing around, he doesn't know what's going on. He's the one that gets attacked. As believers today, we've got to understand that we have enemies. We have an enemy coming against us. And David comes again and says this, again, they're all around me, they've increased, they've multiplied against me. It shouldn't surprise us. Jesus made this statement in John chapter 3, verse 19. And this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. So this, the world just loves, when we see on TV and we see all the different things that are out there and we look and we go, how in the world can anybody believe that? They believe it because it's darkness. They believe it because it's a lie. They believe it because the lie is easier to believe than the truth, because the truth means we have to change our life according to what God's standards are. And people don't want to do that. They want to live in their sin. That's why they attack. That's why they come at us. David's, again, enemies are coming after him. Listen to what the enemies say about David. Psalm chapter 3, verse 2. Many are they who say of me, listen to this, there is no help for him in God. Selah. Now listen, David's saying, they're all around me. They're coming against me. It's my son. He's after me. What they're saying, Lord, is this. There's no help for him in God. Could it be that David stopped for a moment and said, you know what? What they're saying is God's not helping. What they're saying is God's not there. What they're saying is God is not going to help me in this situation. And could it be for a moment, that David stopped and said, are you? Are you there? Because they're coming after me. You told me this was my kingdom. Now I can't even go to my palace. Now I got my son running me. And God, if you really loved me, certainly they're not right. You ever say that? You're in that panic mode, that distress mode, and all of a sudden you look around and you go, God, if you, they're saying, but I think, but I'm just, and before long you're sort of torn. Now, we would never preach that, probably. But it happens, doesn't it? It happens. Our hearts are vulnerable at moments in our life, especially when we're distressed because of the situation. Distressed because of sin, maybe. Distressed because the enemy is coming against us. God, are you really going to help me? And notice the word help here literally means deliverance or salvation or victory. And what they were saying, David, is this. David, we're the great songs of God for victory. Where's your salvation songs now, big boy? Hey, where's all that stuff about God taking care of you now? You're on a run. Everything you had before is gone. Even your own son hates you enough to kill you. Are you kidding me? God's not there. It's the enemy. Where's that salvation from God now? David, where's your victorious life now? What a hurtful statement to come. Have you ever thought about this? That's exactly what the world says to us. Oh, yeah, well, where's your God now with all this going on? If God was truly a God of love, why does he allow this? Why does he allow that? Why does this happen? Why does that happen? If God really loved you, really loved people, then he wouldn't respond the way he does. I think the truth is that's where we struggle today. Many times as believers, we don't live like God loves. We don't live like God cares. We don't live like God's in control. We don't live like God is powerful in our life. We just walk around like the lost world. And is it any wonder that the world looks at the church the way it does today? If your faith and my faith in God is not strong enough to get us through the difficult days, how can a lost man, a lost woman, a lost young person look and say, hey, that's what I need? Remember, the world can't see our God, but they can see our faith. And they can see how powerful our God is by looking at how powerful our faith is. Have you ever thought about that? How the world looks at you and me and they see our faith and they go, you know what? Their faith is strong. God must be real. God must be powerful. God has done a great work in their life. Maybe, just maybe, God can do the same thing in my life. David, there's no help for you in your God. Your God is not there. If he was there, certainly he would do something. We need to live our life, again, for the glory of God. 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 2 says this, no one is holy like the Lord, for there's none besides you, nor is there any rock like our God. That's the way we need to live, don't we? A lot of gods out there, false gods out there that people want to hold on to, but there's none like our God. We need to start living in the midst of a chaotic world like our God counts. Like there is no other God but our God. That's the kind of faith we've got to have today. But David's in panic mode. He's saying, they're all coming against me. My son's coming against me. My kingdom's gone. I'm going to die. They're going to kill me here in a moment. Lord, what I do? But then notice what happens. David goes from panic mode to protection mode. Look what he does here in verse 1 again. He goes from running away in fear. Now he's going to run to the Father in faith, which is where we need to be, isn't it? Instead of running away in fear, just walking, running, we've got to run to the Father in faith. Look what he says in verse 1, Lord, how they have increased who trouble me. Many are they who rise up against me. Many are they who say of me, there's no help for me in God. Selah. Now stop for a moment. I mean, when he says Selah, he says this. He says, stop for a moment, reflect on that. What do you think about that? And David, you can just sort of hear David reflect, can't we, as he's singing a song. Have you ever listened to a song that you're singing, the words? You're not just singing, but you're listening. And all of a sudden, you're singing the words. And then all of a sudden, God speaks to your heart and you go, wow. That's what he's doing. He's saying, God, they're saying all this kind of stuff. They're all coming against me. And he looks and he says, I'm talking to the Lord. This is God I'm talking about. And then he goes on to say this. Listen to what he says. He says, verse 3, but you, O Lord, transitional statement, but you, O Lord, are a shield for me, my glory, and the one who lifts up my head. I cried to the Lord with my voice, and he heard me from his holy hill. And there's the word again, Selah. Pause for a minute, David, reflect. Now he's gone from saying, they're all coming against me, I'm going to die, it's over, to, but you, O Lord, well, you're my shield, you're my rock, it's all about you. See, he's transitioned now his thinking, he's paused for a moment, he's reflecting, and he's come down to now to say, God, you're my protection. They're all going to come against me, but you're my protection. They're all going to hurt me, but you're my protection. And he's come along the side to say this, I'm not going to run from my enemy, I'm going to run to my Father. David didn't have a long time to go through some King James only prayer. Lord, Lord, he just, like Peter said, Lord, save me. I mean, he's just like, Lord, they're coming. Help me. Help me. His life, his kingdom was at stake. And what David reflected on that first part is this, I think it came back to him, his thought, Psalm 46, verse 1, that God was his ever-present help in time of trouble. We forget that, don't we? Have you ever been through something so major, so tragic, so difficult, and you saw God just revive you, just to bring you through it, and then all of a sudden you go through something else, and you forget what he did for you and through you? We do that. I think David forgot for a moment. I think now he comes back to say this, I was defeated, I was depressed, I was doubting, but now, God, it's all about you. It's all about you. One of the purposes of trials and tribulations, you know this, is that it gets us to stop for a moment, reflect, and focus back on God. The old song, Through It All, says this, if I'd never had a problem, I'd never know my God could solve them. That's a true statement. Somehow, God allows these in his sovereign rule to allow us to be knocked off of our feet, only just to get up shortly on our knees and focus on him. He allows that for a purpose. Notice again, Lord, they have increased who trouble me. Many of they rise up against me. Many that say to me, there is no help. But I reflect. but you, O Lord, are a shield. The word shield there is the word megan. It means this. It means a protection. It means, I thought it's interesting, in the translation of it, it sort of tends to use it on the word the scales of a crocodile. And David says, you have protected me. You've shielded all around me. See, he stopped and reflected a little bit. They're all coming after me. They're all going to get me, but you. Now stop for a moment. When did David have that kind of faith? You remember? Remember Goliath? He's out in the field, and he looks. One of the great things about going to Israel was this. One of my favorite places in the world was this, to see where David fought Goliath. And to see how just the valley is this. It's not a very big valley. It's just a valley that goes down here, and just a valley here, a little hill over here. And you can know that's where they went. The Israelites are over here. Little brook David crossed. We went across that brook. Goliath was over here, and you could yell out, and you could hear all the way across. So Goliath up on that hill, he's just saying, he defying the army of Almighty God. He's just talking bad about God and God's people and his army. And David shows up on the scene. Remember what David said? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he defiled the armies of Almighty God? Now, why? He's a shepherd boy. He's not a big warrior. And they said, well, it's Goliath. He's like 9 feet, 8 inches tall. Yeah, and he's sort of, well, truthfully, sir, bottom line, I've killed a lion. I've killed the bear with my sling. This guy's nothing because God will deliver him into my hands. Pretty good faith, isn't it? Pretty strong faith. But now he's running from his son. Stand up against the giant, strong faith. Stand up against his son, run. Sounds like Elijah, doesn't it? That happens, doesn't it? Remember Elijah, prophets of Baal, kills them all. I mean, stands up, fire, I mean, just everything. And then all of a sudden, Jezebel comes and says, listen, tell him this. I'm going to kill him, just like he killed the prophets. And what did he do? He ran for his life. See, there are moments in our life when we are strong in our faith. There's moments in our life when we're weak in our faith. I think David, in the first part of this passage, I think he's a little weak. They're coming after me. They're going to get me. And then all of a sudden, he stops and he says, no. You've been my shield. You've been my protection. You've been my guard. You've taken, and maybe just those thoughts came back to his mind to go, you know what? I was a teenage little boy, and you delivered me. There was no armies that stood up in the world against David when God's hand of protection was on him. And he stood there strong. And maybe David's mind going back to going, you know, man, they all came against me, and nobody could stand because of you, Lord. And now in the midst of his life, in the midst of chaos, a chaotic period, now he's stopping, he's saying, you know what? You're my shield, my glory, and I love this, and the one who lifts up my head. I lift up my head. Psalm 34, verse 7, the angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear him. Isn't that great? Wait, the angel of the Lord encamps, sets up a tent, puts a guard on those of us who fear the Lord. Isn't that great to know? Now, the song, there's a song that you've heard. It says, Thou, O Lord. You've heard the song? Thou, O Lord, our shield. And it says in one part of this song, it's a great song, it says this, and I've never understood this before. It just says, He's the lifter of my head. The lifter of my head. That's just sort of an odd place to put that in a song. He's the lifter of my head. That's where they get the song from, this passage. Psalm 3, but you, O Lord, are a shield for me, my glory, and the one who lifts up my head. Why does he mean lift up my head? Whenever you're discouraged, whenever you're defeated, whenever you feel depressed, what do? You hang your head, don't you? Yeah, that's a great picture. He's just walking. Have you ever done this? Just walked around going, and somebody asks you, say, what's the matter? Nothing. No, I'm all right. Well, no, look up here. Yeah. You ever do that with your kids? They're hurting. They're going through a difficult time. And you look at them and go, what's the matter? Nothing. No, look up here. What's the matter? It's a great picture. David's going, they're going to come and kill me. They're going to just take me out. And God just sort of says, pause for a minute and reflect, son. Stop for a moment and let me look up. Then I love this. Because David, instead of looking at his circumstances, looking at his tools, looking at his sword, looking at everything he's got, his all his armor, and counting the men, 10,000 are coming against me, they're going to do all this kind of stuff. He stops, and God just sort of pauses him in the midst of this and says, look up here, son. I haven't forgot you. You're still mine. And it's almost like God says, I got this. I got this. I don't know about you. I need that from time to time. I need him to say, stop, hey, stop, pause, reflect for a minute. Who are you talking to? Who are you talking to? Look up here. Yes, sir. And it focused David, it refocused David, I believe, to help encourage him. David's hanging his shoulders, he's drooping, he's wore out. Again, you might say, he's beat up by his circumstances of life. And the father says, no, look up, look up. And in verse 1 and 2, again, what you find is this. The only time that God is mentioned in the first two verses is by David's enemies. But beginning at verse 3, David mentions God five times. God was there to meet David's need. And before David, again, knew he had a need, God was there. And God does this. He is, in this situation, in this passage, he demands David's attention. He says, David, stop. And we'll take care of you. I'm going to take care of you. Verse 5, notice this. This is good. He says this. Verse 5 says, I lay down and slept. I awoke, for the Lord sustained me. David's stressful. He's panicking. God says, stop, son. Look up here. Look up here. I'm your shield. Look up here. Hang on. I've got this for you. And now all of a sudden, in the midst of turmoil and trial and chaos and all the just the junk of his life, he stops and he says, I lay down and slept. Whoa, time out. You lay down and slept. Yeah, I woke, for the Lord sustained me. Well, that's interesting, because David, now you're not in that luxury palace that you had. You no longer have the love for the people on your side. You no longer have your soldiers to back you up. Your son's against you. Your family's turned. I mean, really? And now, all of a sudden, now you've got the best sleep of your life? I believe he finally found and discovered the true security that's found only in God. See, if you understand that God's got your back, God's got your front, God's got your sides, he's got below, he's got you shielded and sheltered, I think we can rest pretty easy, even in the midst of chaotic times. There's a lot of people who say, I sleep easy, preacher. Man, I got money in the bank. I got everything I need. I sleep easy. Yeah, okay. Well, yeah, you do, until something happens to that money in the bank, till something happens to that health, till something happens to the family, till something happens to the job, till something happens. Before long, you just look around. We cannot live our life based on the circumstances of life. We must live it on the controlling power of our God, who loves us and sustains us. David went from panic mode, he went to protection mode, running to the Father in faith. And then thirdly, we'll just close with this. David rested. He rested in the power mode. In the power mode. When you run to the Father in faith, he empowers us with grace. God empowers us with grace that only he can give. And I found this to be true. And I don't know about you. God always gives his grace right on time. He does. I'm looking, going, God, I could have used this yesterday. He said, nope, wouldn't help you yesterday, but it helps you today. He does it in his timing, in his way. David was not on the throne, but God still was. That's what you need to remember. You may not be in charge of something, but God is. At verse 5, he says, I lay down and slept. I awoke, for the Lord sustained me. Listen to this. I will not be afraid of 10,000s of people who have set themselves against me all around. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God, for you have struck all my enemies on the cheekbone. What's he talking about there? In the past. God, you've taken care of all my enemies before. Why should I worry about these? You have broken the teeth of the ungodly. All the ungodly that came against David in the kingdom. Verse 8, salvation belongs to the Lord. See, bottom line is this. In verse 1, he didn't say that. Verse 1 is, they're going to kill me. It's all about me. I have me and me and me and me and me. And then at the very end of it, he says, no, I've reflected on this. I've looked at this and I've examined this whole thing. God, you've lifted my head to help me stop and look at you, not me. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessing is upon your people. And then the last word there is what? Selah. Selah. God's saying to him, think about that, buddy. Reflect on that. And as you're singing this song, as they're singing this song, they stop for a moment and they look and they say, you know what? Let's reflect on that. Reflect on what God has done. And what we see is two things and we're done. David's courage came back. Psalm 3 verse 6, I will not be afraid of 10,000s of people who have set themselves against me all around. Why is that? Because he's got faith in God now. His faith in God is strengthened. That same God. David's saying this, 10,000 of them? Yeah, I'd bring them on. Just like the big giant, just like all the ones that came against me. These guys are nothing for my God. And let me just stop for a moment and pull it back to where we are. Virus, politics, economy, whatever. You fill in the blank. It's not too big for God. Not too big for God. We're to live resting in his power. How could David say that? Because, again, he trusted the Lord. 2 Samuel chapter 22, verse 47. The Lord lives. Blessed be my rock. Let the God be exalted, the rock of my salvation. It is God who avenges me and subdues the peoples under me. He delivers me from my enemies. You also lift me up above those who rise against me. You have delivered me from the violent man. And what a great picture that is for us today. David's courage came back. When you take your eyes off yourself and your focus on your circumstance, take all of that off, the fear, and you put it back on God, your courage to stand in faith will be strong again. Lastly, David's confidence came back. His courage came back, his confidence came back. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessing is upon your people, Selah. And the word he uses here for salvation in verse 8, it's the same word he used for deliverance in verse 2. It translates victory. Victory. David figured it out. Any situation he faces belongs to the Lord. So let's just close with this. You're here listening today and you say, you know what? I'm going through a time, Ron. It gets bad. It gets worse. It just gets crazy. Watch this. Maybe you want to focus back on your faith in God and recall where he's taken you, the journey he's brought you through, and stop for a moment and just say, reflect and say, God, you're right. It's about you. I'm not afraid of anything because of you. It's going to happen, Lord, the way you want. It's going to happen the way you will it to be. And I'm just going to trust you, and I'm going to live my life for your glory and for your praise. Isn't that the way we need to live our life? The faith in God doesn't mean we're careless and just go jumping off cliffs. What it means is this. It means we stop for a moment and reflect in the midst of our trials and tribulations, chaotic times, and say, God, I'm going to rest because you're in control of all this. And what a great picture that is for all of us today as we think about our relationship to God. Do you know Christ? Question today is this. Who are you trusting? Who are you trusting? Are you trusting in the world? You trusting the circumstances of life? Or are you trusting in God? Right where you're at home, listening today, I'd just like you to bow your head. Bow your head for a moment. Just ask yourself the question. Lord, who am I trusting? Chaotic times, no doubt about it. And your circumstance may be just grievous and painful. But I can tell you this, no matter who you are, God is the lifter of your head. He is the one that gets the glory in your life and mine. And we will be victorious, above victorious, in Christ and Christ alone. Do you know Jesus is your Savior? Do you know him? Jesus would say this in John 17, this is eternal life, that they may know you and Jesus Christ whom you've sent. The only way you can know God is through faith in Christ. Do you know him today? Have you trusted him as your Savior? You say, Ron, I'm just struggling in this world. Listen, to be a child of God, you just, again, have to recognize who God is. Put your faith and trust in him and say, oh God, I believe you're the great God of heaven. And I believe with all my heart that you sent your son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross for my sins. Lord, I'm asking you right now, forgive me of my sin. The Bible says all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's you, that's me, that's all of us. But if in your heart today you'd say, you know what, man, I'm struggling. Can I just help you with this? If in your heart you say, you know what, I just feel God wants me to trust him. That's the Holy Spirit dealing with your heart to say yes to him. And I would just encourage you this morning to say, I want to believe in Jesus. I give my life to Christ. Lord, save me today. Come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins. It's not about magic words and formulas. It's about an attitude of your heart that says, oh God, I need you. And I turn to you. And right now, wherever you're at, if in your heart you say, you know what? I want to pray and ask Christ to come into my life. You just call upon his name in your own words and ask him to forgive you and save you. And he'll change you today. He'll save your life. And he'll take you where he wants you to be. And he'll again be the one that lifts your head and gives, again, you gives him the glory and praise as you live your life for him. If you are listening today and you say, Ron, that's me. I want to give my life to Christ. I want to trust him. Or I pray and ask Christ to come in my life. Or you say, Ron, I've got some other situations I'm going through. I'd like someone to pray with. Man, we'd love to help you with that. On the screen, you're going to see the address, the email address of our church. It's sfultonbaptist@bellsouth.net. If you'd like someone to pray with, or you want my personal email. My personal email is livingtheword@hotmail.com. And you say, Ron, I want to talk to somebody about getting saved. I want to talk to somebody about what it means to give my life to Jesus. I had a guy not too long ago, he emailed me and said, hey, I want to give my life to Christ. And he's prayed and given his life to Christ. We'll baptize him soon. But that may be you today. Say, you know what? I just want to know Jesus. Or maybe a special prayer request that God's laid on your heart we can help you with. We'd love to help you, serve you in any way we can. But if today you say, you know what? I need Christ. I need God in my life. We would love to help you. We'll get with you and give you some material, help you, show you how the Bible teaches about what you can know about being saved and how you can follow Christ in your life. And we'd love to do that for you. I'd like to pray for us, and then we'll be dismissed. Again, don't forget, next week we'll be meeting in person at 8:30 and 10:30. And then also we'll be coming on still on live on Facebook, I believe, on the internet and the website and the app also at 10:30. So just be in prayer as God leads you. And again, we appreciate your love and support. Father, thank you for our time together today. Strengthen us, Lord, as we just reflect on you, as we pause in the midst of chaotic times to say thank you for all you do, or we lose sight of you sometimes. Easy to do. But help us to pause for a moment today, and help us, Father, to sense again your spirit, your leadership in our life as we stand on the Word of God through faith in Jesus Christ. And I pray, Father, today, if there's anyone that doesn't know you as Savior, that, Father, your Holy Spirit will draw them to you by faith, and they'll receive you through faith in Jesus Christ for eternal salvation. Father, we bless you, we praise you, we just ask for your will to be done. And you be glorified in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.